Recording. So, my talk for today, it's can be phrased as types as values and values as types. So, first question, anybody familiar with templates in C++? So you're all template wizards, that's great. If not, we can very easily start. I should disable the. Okay. So, why did I delete everything? So, we get a type. But it's not a type. It is a type, but it does not represent a type. So, if we make a template around that, this actually represents any type. So it's also the easiest template you can write because it's basically an empty struct. So I can create any instances of any type, even if the type for the template that I give through the template is not instantiable. And yeah, so we should try to use it. But it's quite boring because, yeah, we can now type int. And it's some int. But it's empty, so what's the use of an empty struct? So what we do here is just exploring possibilities of the language a bit. So easy templates, easy. So let's build, just to make sure we didn't have an error. And we have, we don't have a main. Let's do main. Main needs to return an int. And I have deleted everything again, because I left type, obviously. OK, no more errors, just a warning that we have not used our variable. And yeah, to make something useful, we could say, OK, let's compare two types. So let's write an operator to compare two types, type A and the type B. OK, and obviously we need templates for both A and B because any idea how to implement it? Exactly. So we won't write any useful code today because everything is already here. We can use the C++ type traits and just return standard the same value A, B. Okay, so now we can make our test a little bit more interesting and ask the question like, is some int equal to a type in 32t? Do I need a header int types? I guess so. Okay, and it's still the type, so we have to instantiate this type. Okay, this compiles, hopefully, but it's not interesting because we still don't know if it's the same or not. So let's use static assert here. And assert that both are the same. So it's not a static assertable, so we need to make it const expert, obviously, so it can compile at compile time or run at compile time. Try again. Now it compiles. And as it compiles, it already has stated that both types are equal. But yeah, Visual Studio doesn't know it. It doesn't know anything about the compiler here. And yeah, but still a little bit ugly. So we still have types here. So we don't want to have type, we want to have types as values. So let's make a helper function or a helper thing and say lowercase type is an instance of our type. So we do that when we can simplify this expression. And now it's much more readable. Agreed? And it should still compile, obviously. But can we do more? Like now, basically testing for attributes of types is one thing. Another thing would be manipulating types, generating new types, like removing a pointer. So let's write a function. Remove pointer from any type A. And what would the result of this function be? Any suggestions? No, never null pointer. You remove a pointer. And there's a type trait for that. It's remove pointer t. As I said, we won't write any code. Remove pointer from A. But that's not the return type, because this would have to be a type that can be returned. And to get around it, we wrap it again as a type or pretty construct again. And a method implementation is basically returning, because everything we are interested in is the return type, not the value, as for all the type instances. So how would it look like if we test for it? We make ourselves a void pointer. That's basically a type void pointer.
Don't waste too much.
No.
A.
No. It's all nice and pretty. So after removing a pointer from void pointer, it should be void. Really? What's this? So it compiles. And can we still static assert it? So we don't have to run anything, because running things is so 90s. And it's not working, because a remove pointer operation is not const expert. So let's do that. And great, it works. And now, if you read that, it really looks like normal C++ code, but you're not treating types. You're treating not treating normal variables, but you're treating types. And basically, you can treat types as normal variables. So that's the first trick I wanted to show you. So what else do we do? Any suggestions? One thing would be, if we have a equal, we can also make a not equal. Let's make it more usable and use it later. So nautical, what's the implementation of nautical? It's like any other not equal implementation. It's basically not equal A and B. And for that, we need variable names on the parameters. So, like any other normal code.
Excuse me, why the word C++ says that two braces are at fault?
Here? Because it's dumb. No, it's I'm using the Clang compiler here and not the Visual Studio compiler. So the Visual Studio doesn't know what is right and what is wrong. So it will also not be very helpful with suggestions about anything. So don't let yourself be fooled by the compiler. It compiles, and that's the main thing. So let's make another operation. So how about getting a size of a type? Would that be size of type? Result obviously should be a size t. And how to implement it? Yeah, it's most simple. Yeah, let's test it so we don't make. So size of our sum int, what should it be? Four. And we can assert that it's int 32t, so it should be 4 bytes, 32 bits. What am I doing? Does it compile? Yeah, it compiles, so we were right. And just to prove that you're really right, if you remove that, nothing works. Static assert failed. So obviously we do something right here. And I would suggest one more thing. Our type construct is very basic up here. So this is our empty struct. But we can place any type as t. So we can also place type of any other t as a t. So to prevent that, we don't want to have this recursion of types. We can make a custom overload and say, well, it's not allowed. What would this look like? Basically, we have any t and say, if our type is instantiated, the template is instantiated with a type of t, then this is recursive and should not be allowed. So there's a neat trick if you ever want to do that. You cannot simply write false here. We already know we don't want that. But then this static assert would always be false. So it will never compile. We have to trick the compiler to think, okay, this is wrong because of the template arguments. And how do we do that? If we have a type t, it's quite simple. We can simply instantiate our type t and say, I don't care what really is, but we use false. Because if you have a brace and only the second part of the brace is the value of the result, the comma operator, basically. The first part is discarded, no matter what it is. But it depends on t, on the template argument. So the compiler cannot know what this expression will be unless it knows t. So that's the trick. And now we can give the user a nice error message and say recursion is not allowed here. Type. Template, so, yeah. The normal 17?
The
Yeah, we have 2018. Well, what are you using? That's basically the latest snapshot build of the Clang compiler. So it's like the early snapshot of the 7.0 Clang compiler. But it really doesn't matter. It works with the 6.0 as well. So far, nothing. It's very simple. But we will use more template features later, I guess. Just playing around with types so far. We have no real life. We're here in the C++ user group. Exactly. Yeah. The underlying concept is the same concept that Boost HANA uses for all those tricks and heavy magics. But this is a very light introduction to the topic. So, and you can play around with your own code and make it easier readable and also writable. And one real pain point with template metaprogramming so far is that you cannot read it very easily. But if you write it, your tools like that, the tools are very easy, as you have seen. There's no magic in the size of and operators. It's just very basic functions. And already you have a very strong tool to describe what you want. So your metaprogramming becomes really easily expressible. That's the main motivation around that. Okay, before we move on, let's write one more thing. Sometime in the future, you will be asked to give the T of the type T. Because somebody wants to make an instance of a variable with this type, for instance. So how would we do that? And I would suggest we make a simple function again. It's call it unwrap. And it gets this type T. And should return T. But how would you implement that? You don't. Why would you ever want to implement that? You don't know how to instantiate T. You could make a list of arguments and also on to get a constructor going, but why do we care? That's the unwrap method. And now you ask, how would you use any of these unwrap methods? Let's test it out. Test unwrap. We again make our int type. It's just the type int. And now we want to create a value and use the unwrap function with the int type and create an instance of the returning type. What we do not really call the unwrap method. We just use it to get the T and say, OK, give me the type of the return type of this method and make it an instance and 23. And now we can just return this value, for example. Compiles. So we burden the user of this unwrap function to use the decal type. But then again, we could make a new, another wrapper to mitigate that. I've not prepared that. Shall we try? Let's make this unwrap func and using unwrap is not possible. It is possible, yeah. But it's not possible without the unwrap function. Just copy that. This is our T. And we have to call it func. And now we can, we have to use, small brackets again, should work. No, what's not? Okay, this cannot work because we have a variable of this type, not a class T. So let's discard that. It's not prepared, so it won't work anyway. Okay, so any questions on that part? So using types as values, first part. Now we can guess what the second part is. Now we want to use values as types. And this is more interesting. So far, this is what BooSigner does. But the other way around, I have not found many materials. I know, but before we do that, we can go more crazy on the types thing. You have all master templates so far. Okay, so, and if you want to up your level on template magic, you have to use the three dot thing. And the most basic thing you can do is, again, make a something like a type, but it's called type pack, and it's empty struct with any amount of arguments. And again, we like this lowercase type thing here. We can do the same with for the type pack. Just extend some dots here. Name it type pack and call type pack. And now we have to place dots here. Anybody not familiar where to place three dots and what they do? Okay. What you do is you say in the template, you're stating you want something named T of the type from the left. So class names, you want to give it a type. Not a value, a type. And it's really nothing different because you can replace it with type name also. There's no difference between a type or a class here in templates. And if you have, want to have multiple, you add some dots here. You say T represents a pack of types. And if you use it, you say unroll this T. So what you want here is all the T's in the type pack, comma separated as a list for giving it. And with this basic rule, you know how to use the dots. There's no, nothing more. You can only declare a type pack and unroll the type pack with some dots. Okay, how would you use it? You say type pack test. And you would say, yeah, we have an int, a float, and a char in a type pack. So let's make it int, char, and float. For the type packs, it's very awkward to come up with good examples. They will always look like int, char, and float. Maybe a double. But every other type is, yeah, you would have to include something and so on. But with type packs, we have more operations we can do. For example, we want to implement an append method. So we get a type pack. Really? I can try. Okay, append a type pack with some types in that. And we want to append another type B. Okay, so we need some arguments. So this is A, and we have a B. Any idea on how to implement that? It's again quite simple. We just return another type pack. It says that all the types of A and then B. And it's still an empty struct, so we can return it later. So. It works, yeah. It will not work if you have to give the template parameters. But if they are deduced from the arguments, it works. Check it. Yeah, it's not used, but it compiles. So obviously we want to test that. Take our test method and yeah, want to make one more. So we have now an int, a float, a char, and a double. Why is nobody telling me that the order is wrong here? Int, float, and char. So we want to append to our int, float, char, a type, double. Nice. Still compiles. So obviously nothing too wrong, but we are missing the equals operator. So we can compare it and make really sure it works. Let's do that. And this is a bit more tricky, but let's write down the signature. So we have a pack A and a pack B and implement the operator, equals. On our type pack A and the type pack B. Should return bool, obviously. Can also be const expo. So we don't forget it later. But how to implement that? Recursively? No, we are not set magically. C++ has advanced enough, so we don't need recursion anymore. Obviously, a folder expression, but we need to make sure, first, both type packs have the same amount of content. So if there are different number of types, it's obviously not equal. Let's make that. Because our folder expression would complain if we try to fold two non-equal packs. So how do we find out how many entries we have? This is a sizeof operator. It's a new sizeof operator that is specialized on just giving us how many types are in these packs. So when both have the same amount of packs, then we want to do something, but let's first not equal, and then it's obviously false. So first part we already have mastered. Now the interesting second part. So we already have our type equals. So we could write something like type A and type B equals. But A and B are packs, so we have to unpack some. Let's make another round of brackets around here and unpack it. Like that. What it now does is the C++17 unfolding. Basically, the left expression, the only expression we have next to the dots, is repeated for all the entries of A and B. So it's instantiated, is the first type equal to the first type of B? Second type of A, second type of B, and so on. Because we have ensured that both are the same size, both packs, We don't have any leftovers or anything, so it works, and the compiler has no reason to complain. So if we have that, now we can test if our append really works. Let's make a static assert that our int float char double is equal to a type peg with int float char and double. No. Yeah, it's late. Let's see, compiles, great, it's equal. So equal operator works, and also our append method works. But if we have those pegs, we might want to do transformations on them, like removing the pointer of all the types. You don't want to do that. You want best thing ever. So let's build a transform algorithm for type pegs. Isn't it exciting? I don't know. Transform. So what's our signature of a transform for type peg? First is we have to pass it a type peg. Let's name it T. And the second part is we need someone who transforms it. So if you want to treat types as variables, then we can also generate lambdas that treat types. Let's do that and take an F. So we have a peg T. I have to scroll up again. And yeah, and an F. So console explorers required. I don't know why, but okay. Any idea how to implement that? In the body or in the return type? Yeah, exactly. Because our new return type is a type peg as well, where each type is changed. So the return type is a type peg. And we want to call with a type of T. So F is our lambda. We call it with an instance for each T. At the end, we do some dotting. But the return type of the lambda could never be a T. It can only be a type of T, but our type pegs contain T and not type T. So now our unwrap comes into play. So we call unwrap, and I hit the button. On the result of the F. And our unwrap is not really usable, so we need to get the type of the unwrap, decal type. And that's it. Easy. Like everything. I don't know where the difficulty is. Look at the implementation, just curly braces, nothing. So you don't believe me that it works, do you? Let's do a test again. And we need some input. Let's make it a simple type peg of int and void pointer. So we now need a lambda, or yeah, let's write it in one line, transform our input with a lambda obviously the argument type is not known. It's just something type t, and we return our remove pointer from t. Easy as that. And we have that. We can make a static assert again to ensure it works really. So our output should be equal to a type peg. What's the output? Int and void. Oh. Seems like the compiler is really loving us today. So let's go crazy. Any questions on that part? Yeah? Because we have forgotten it. Where does it, it's just, you mean the static assert here? Strange thing. Somehow the compiler does figure out we never do anything with the variables. It's always empty structs. I don't know. Let's place it here and feel better. Everything should be const expert. What is missing void? Oh. It's no void, it's just auto. Because we have the return type at the end. And it's really a part where you can only place the return type at the end, because in the front you wouldn't know the types. Any other questions on type pegging? So now we go to the values as types. So let's turn it around. You know the standard integral type declarations? Basically, it looks like that. So you have a template where you say, okay, it's any type t, and an instance of this type t called v. So we have a type and a value of this type. And this is a standard integral constant. But now with C++17, this looks really ugly because we can do much better now. When we define that, we don't want to make a complex template, we make a simple template. And it's the simplest template you can imagine. Looks like that. We can obviously make it a bit more complex and say, okay, what's the type, for instance? So the value type, or just the type, what is it? It's not defined, so we have to take it out of the value and say, give me the type of the value, so we know the type of the value. Otherwise, we don't know it. If you can instantiate a template with it, we can also make it a extra constant. So we don't know the type again, so we don't care. And just assign it like that. I use a shorter version instead of value, it just do this. And then if we really want to, we can make a conversion operator. C++ now has two of those. It's not pretty. So let's do just one. If you could choose, which one would you choose? You know how to read those? The first one is basically a conversion operator. So it's an operator with a type. And it converts instances of this type to this value type. And the second one is the call operator. So if you call your integral constant, you get the value as a result of this function. I don't want to call my values. I don't know why you should do that. Let's do it like that. But we don't have to write it that complicated. There's a new operator, it's called auto. And no accept, we don't care, and it's just we. So much better now. So we have a const extra operator auto. I don't know if C++ can get much more prettier. Okay, if we have that, how would we use it? We can now say, okay, let's create a type that represents a value, like making a one. We always need a one. It's just one. And it's much better than the old one, because if you use integral constant, you would have to specify the type. So something like int one. That's ugly. We don't do that. Remove it. So we have this. Okay, what other values would we need in our programs? I would argue 42 as a value we always need. Very well. Let's do a compile, so check it, no type error. Nice, works. If you have two values now, what would you want to do with two values? Obviously, you want to add both, so you can generate infinite amount of values. Okay, how would a add look like for these kinds of type? Any idea? No. Let's show it. You're here because I'm typing and you can listen. So obviously we need two values represented as types, A and B. And the result again would be a type representing the resulting value. So it's a value again. And we now have to add the value of A and the value of B. It's obvious. That's not obvious. That is nice. You always need tests, right? Test add. And static assert. Add 1 and 42. And yeah, now we are stuck. But what we can do is just take the value out of that type and compare it to 43, I would say. Compiles. So we have, seems we have done something right. Great. Now we know values are great. There are some more values that are of rigorous importance to us. So something like pi. Any idea? Would it work? Obviously not, because a double is not an integral value. It is not really representable by the binary representation. So it's not possible, not allowed. That's really unfortunate, because we need other values as well, something like a hello, where you would have to have some string. But doesn't compile as well, because strings are not represented as integral values. So basically, character arrays, and character arrays are not an integral value arrays. That's unfortunate. So we have to stop using C++. Do we? Ah, no, no, no. There's an fortunate occurrence in C++ that function pointers are integral values. And another fortunate thing, that lambdas that do not capture anything can be converted to function pointers. So the only thing we have to do is uncomment this out, because it's not working. It's always good to comment out code that is not working. Just remove it. And we have to make another specialization of our value and say, okay, we don't take any v, just a function pointer. So let's make it f, function pointer. This doesn't get any parameters, but returns any value. We don't care which order. And make a specialization on our template, like that, and say, okay, if f is a function pointer, then obviously our value is not the function pointer itself, but the result of calling this function. And our type, obviously, is whatever type v has. And yeah, conversion should also be possible. So now we can support a Pi. How would it look like? How would you write a Pi now with a lambda? You cannot simply write a lambda and return. That's too easy. Not working. Won't compile. Test it. No. Yeah. There's one thing missing, because our template says our value accept any type of v. The compiler doesn't know we want to make a lambda conversion to a function pointer. So now we have to force this conversion, and everything is happy. So how would you do that? Is this a neat little trick? What? Is this?
Yeah.
Plus, yeah, exactly. How do you know? Nice. And that's the trick. So let's compile. See the trick working? Yeah. Just compiles fine. And the same we can do with hello. Just compiles. It's like, yeah, exactly. Only a bunch of braces. Seems like every brace wants to be in a place in this. And also the plus sign, because. And obviously, if you write a function like test hello, that returns just a const character pointer, you can just return instance of our type hello. Because of our magically auto-converting value type. Isn't it great? Unfortunately, there's no const express thing I can do to show you it really working. If you mind, we have to switch to the compiler explorer and look at the assembly, but we can do it later. It's working. And it's really creating a constant in your program. Hello, it's 5 characters and a 0. And returning it from the method like nothing happened. Like you would have written a constant instead of the hello instance. Okay, now there's one thing missing. Just adding 2 value doesn't cut it. We can add every value we get. So let's make a sum. So a sum is a template that gets many values represented as types and returns just one new value. Yeah, our add was simply implemented like that. We could do the same, but it's, yeah, can do better now because we can write our lambda. Ah, there's one thing we can optimize here. These braces are not needed. Yeah, I know it. Sorry. So just add all the values together and return it in our lambda. I know it's universal. Even strings could be added if we implement a method that adds strings together. Yeah, we have to write the return types, otherwise the conversion wouldn't trigger our magic outer conversion. What's up? Brackets? Yeah, brackets. Yeah. So we may now use just another random value, just because it's so nice and I always like to write this, and it's now minus 23. Something is missing. That's, and our return would be a sum of 42. Our v2 and pi. And that's obviously a valid method. So, any questions so far? It's basically like plus 5, so it ensures it's a positive number, and every pointer is a positive number. So the only thing a lambda could do to be a positive number is to convert a pointer, and then the pointer is used or capped because it's still positive, and it's working. Unfortunately, it's only working in the Clang compiler right now. The Visual Studio compiler doesn't accept this plus sign here. In the Visual Studio compiler, you are forced to write a method that basically does the same. Just convert the argument type to a pointer type. Once you do that, it's the same as in Clang. That's quite good. It's also not supporting the template auto thing, so it's already stopping in the first line here. That's this part. No. Currently, only Clang supports the full standard on this. The GCC compiler, I don't know if it accepts that, but it will fall down on the lambda because it's a bug in the compiler that simply states if there's a lambda in a template argument, say you have a lambda in a template argument, that's an error. There's a bug filed by Eric Niebler in April last year and was not touched until I hit it again and said, you have to fix that. I don't know if they are fixing it now. You should do it well as well, and then they have to fix it. If there are 20 plus signs on this bug, it becomes important. Right now it's P3, and you know only priority 1 and priority 2 are ever done. So
we are stuck with
C-Lang. Not stuck. It's the best compiler, so it works everywhere. That's nice. Okay, any other questions? I hope plus sign is explained a bit. There's one obvious question, obviously. What would you do with that kind of shit? And there are many applications, and I want to show you one. And the best part is, you know, standard optional. It's just stating a value is a valid value or invalid. And for most use cases, it's enough. But there are many use cases where you say, ah, damn, I have an enum that says error or any kind of success, whatever the return success was. And there's also something like returning an int, and you say minus 1 is the error code and everything else is success, like how many bytes have returned or at which position I have found the location of your substring. So what you really want to express is, I have an integer with some specific value that marks this integer as invalid. And this is also known as a packed optional. And with this kind of feature, we can write a really compact packed optional. Yeah, I don't want to implement a full optional here. I just want to implement a packed part. So I suggest that you want to choose one way you have the packed optional and one way you have the unpacked optional, like the normal standard option. So the syntax optional like that, and here goes your normal implementation. I would suggest wrap standard optional and add whatever functions you need. So it's just optional of an integer, and it's either instantiated the integer, so it's a valid integer, or it's not an integer. But to represent it, you need another bool that says, is this instantiated a valid or not? So size of an optional would be 8 bytes at least. So the packed optional is then an overload on our normal optional. We say, okay, we just give a template the value of the invalid part. And optional, I can write it. So, and this is wrapped around a new value. So we don't have to implement it again. And this would only represent one value of your value type. What's the value type? Using value type. And it's the decal type of your value V. And obviously, in the standard case, you want to make it invalid. So invalid value. And our invalid value is the value of our V. We use our value again and the V because we have implemented two overloads already. One where integral values like integers are easily representable, and one where we represent lambdas for the default value. So we don't have to do this shenanigan again here, just use our value we already have. So if we have that, then we can write an operator bool and say return value equals invalid value. No, not equals. And this can also be done in const expo, so let's do it. And we want also something like reset. Maybe reset it to an invalid value. Invalid value. I have to scroll again. I see. And also something like set value type. Yeah, you get the idea. And maybe you also have something like get, but basically I suggest that you represent the same interface that your standard option has, so you can use both interchangeably. Questions on that, or should I show that it works? Hmm? Why would it not work? Value, yeah, it's too easy. You would have catched that. Yeah, let's make a dump test. Make a default name, and this is our value. This is a lambda, and you return Max Mustermann. Obviously, if the name is that value, then it's wrong. And our optional name is then just optional from default name. Yeah. So we use constant, where we have defaulted the name. And now our static assert should say it's really defaulted. So it's invalid. And scrolling in. When we try to get the value, then we have not no getter so far, so let's build it as well. Const expo auto get const return value defaulted get should be equal to a default name value. Right? Not working. There's error. What was that? Let's do that. Because obviously the value type, yeah. We cannot use the we value because we have to interpret it with our value system to get a real value. Okay, compiles. Great. And these compact optionals are really useful. I use it everywhere. Because especially in legacy APIs, you always have some invalid values and so on. And just wrap it, and it's much more easy to use. You cannot really use it wrong. They're more elaborated packed optional libraries, but yeah. Only what you can write, you can understand. And So is this enough of a use case, or do you need another use case? Really? So you will have to be brave to get this other use case. And let me introduce you a use case before you all run out and say, well, I don't know why you want to do that. Basically, what I want is I want to implement a callable. So basically, any method should get callable with just a memory represented just by a vector of some bytes. So basically, you want to generate a scripting interface for normal C++ functions. Where you just get a memory, and then you can call your regular C++ functions. And so far, it's very difficult to do so scripting interfaces. I don't claim I show you everything here, but really the twist would be we create a callable where we get any function f, basically a function pointer, and make it callable with our memory. So you don't know how to implement that so far, but that's the basic strategy we want to aim for. Our test would look like that. We create a function. Normally our functions would be global functions, but we can really use our lambda trick again here, just to show it off one more time. And now we have some real arguments. And yeah, make a stupid function, return e plus equals 23. Because our I is a reference to an integer, we should change it really. So that's not the instance, that's the callable type. Now we create an instance with another curly braces. So, and then we make an instance of our memory. Memory, like that. And now return our instance called with the memory. So what's missing is we have to initialize the memory, obviously. Wouldn't work like that. And also the implementation of our callable. So far, so clear? Is this a good use case? You always wanted to do that, don't you? Okay. The standard apply method is basically a new concept of C++ 17. And you give it a callable, and as a second argument, a tuple of all your arguments. So what is really missing is we need a method that makes these memory as arguments. And what we really need to know is what are the is a tuple type of all the arguments of our method f. So tuple is equals to some magic. Any idea how would you get the argument types of this f? Have you ever done it? It's kind of easy if you know the trick. And the trick is you have to use a method, as we have used it before, for the unwrap. Use the same trick for the arguments here. And when we write a method that accepts a pointer to a function, any pointer to a function, how would it look like? We have a return type, we have a pointer to this function, and we have a list of arguments. So args dot dot dot. So let's make a template to get all that. So we have declared that. And now what we want to, as a result, we want a standard tuple as a result. So it's a tuple with all the arguments. return type we ignore, but the arguments are important because we have to call it. And our return is again just empty. So how do we get a tuple of f now? Use tickle type again and call our argument tuple method. Is f. And f is already the instance. So once we have that, we can get all the necessary details we need to know. For example, we need to know how large has the memory to be. Otherwise, we could not really call it. So how large should it be? It's exactly as large as our tuple. Because the tuple is representing all or holding all our arguments. And now we need this as arguments method. So we get our memory and should return a tuple. First, we want to make sure it's the size is correct. So let's write an assert. And memory size should equal our size. And if it's the right size, then we have just reinterpret our memory as the tuple. Reinterpret cast tuple. Like that. That's everything. Okay, now we have to complete our test. So how should we initialize our memory? We resize it to the right size, obviously. So it's ink size. And then we need something to reference to. So we need an integer I that is 0. And now, yeah, that's the tricky part. I could not come up with any readable solution because we still have to use a reinterpret cast because the tuple now contains a reference. And this reference is really a pointer. And we have to treat it like a pointer. Otherwise, we could not set the pointer. If we try to set a reference later, it's not possible in C++. So we still have to do it manually. Normally, you would write your tooling to just do that. And now store the pointer to I in our memory. And then the call should work. Let's compile here. Yeah. And maybe just so for the show, we run one program because if you don't show any running program, nobody believes that you're actually doing C++. So Airstream and just standard test call. Stream not fine. That's the errors missing. Okay, debug it. Run without debugging. Yeah, 23. And to show it's really working, we can call it again. So somehow it has to do something right. Okay. Any questions on that part? Yeah, and I reinterpret this pointer to a pointer to a pointer to int. Exactly. So I tried everything, but I could not come up with a shorter thing. If some C++ expert says you can do it more easy, then just tell me. But what I need is a writable pointer to I. So, and if I dereference this int pointer, it's an int pointer and it is writable. And I could not come up with something like that. Just, I don't know, doesn't want me to do that. It's basically something like that should be shorter. But it doesn't compile, does it? It compiles. Does it work? It works again. All right. Okay, you have to try harder. Okay, any other questions? Otherwise, I thank you for your attention and we are closed for today. I don't have anything else prepared. If you have questions, then ask them. Otherwise, we see us in March again.